student, welcome here in this YouTube channel initiated by Gnanmanjari Modern School. Unit number 9, Movements Toward a New World, especially new world for us, for India. Means which kind of activities were being done at the time of that getting freedom and how we abolished the British rules as well as British policies from India. Who were sacrificed their life for getting freedom? This all is about this number three unit in New World. Now in this video we'll meet, means Gandhiji will be there, means where and when Gandhiji just came and he just saw the scenario of Indian people, the suffering and pain of Indian people under the British rule, and how he just started that Satyagraha movement and all. That will be discussed in this video. Please keep a book with you. And we are here on page number 27. Here we'll discuss Rowlatt Act, we'll discuss Jallianwala Bagh incident, we'll discuss arrival of Gandhiji into India, and if time will permit, we'll discuss Khilafat movement too. Okay, Morley Minto reform. In 1909, the English adopted the policy of divide and rule to create enmity between Hindus and Muslims in 1906. So that divide and rule policy, which was introduced by Britishers, and the purpose of that divide and rule policy was to just create differences or create enmity between Hindu and Muslims. Under the leadership of Aga Khan, Muslim delegation met Viceroy Minto. Morley was the Indian Wazir at that time. These reforms are known as Morley-Minto reforms. So under this kind of situation, the leadership of Aga Khan, that Muslim uprising we can say, that met Viceroy Minto. Divide and rule policy. Aga Khan met Minto, and Morley was Indian Wazir at that time. These reforms are known as Morley-Minto reform. Now number 2 is arrival of Gandhiji to India. Gandhiji returned to India in 1915. After successfully fighting against racism in South Africa with Satyagraha. So before 1950, Gandhiji was there in South Africa and he was just fighting that movement of racism in there. His political mentor, that is guru, was Gopal Krishna Gokhale, and spiritual mentor was Srimad Ramchandra, from whom he got inspiration. So two well-known persons were there to guide Gandhiji. So he just believed his mentor, that he believed Gopal Krishna Gokhale as his mentor, and that a spiritual mentor he was considering to Srimad Rajchandra. Gandhiji traveled across India and observed the life of Indians, which was very plightful and poor as well as suffering. He considered exploitation as the root of poverty in India and made plans to abolish British rule in India. So when he just came to India, he just saw the plightful situation of Indian people and he just observed poverty, which he considered that root of all the things. So he just decided to remove British rule or British policy from India. So in 1915, he came. His guru, Gopal Krishna Gokhale, and spiritual mentor Srimad Rajchandra. He noticed that he considered exploitation as the root of poverty. Exploitation. And he made plans to abolish poverty or British rule. From India. So when Gandhiji arrived, after seeing the situation of Indian people, he just made plan for how to just remove that British policy as well as Britishers from India. That he just made plan. Number three is Rowlatt Act. In 1919. The British government formed the Rowlatt Act under the chairmanship of Rowlatt, the Minister of Law. So there was a person, or we can say law minister, whose name is Rowlatt. And under his chairmanship, this act British government has made. And that's why it is known as Rowlatt Act. Minister of Law Act was passed, and that's why known as Rowlatt Act. This act was framed with the purpose of suppressing revolutionaries and nationalized activity. So as you know that at that time the situation means became people of India became revolutionaries. Means that the energy or spirit of revolution was there in each and every Indian's mind. They just arose, that nationalism was arised at that time. So the purpose of passing this Rowlatt Act was to suppress this whole revolutionary as well as nationalist activity. This act seemed to be known as Black Act because it was meant to suppress individual freedom and freedom of speech. This can be known, or this act was considered as a Black Act because it suppressed people's freedom and freedom of speech. To suppress activities, to suppress the freedom, and that's why known as Black Act. According to this act, any suspicious person could be arrested and jailed without conducting any trial against him. That's why Gandhiji called this called it Black Act, and Motilal Nehru considered it as a snatching away of argument, appeal and advocacy. So under this act, that Britishers passed a law or passed a rule that any person who were in favor of nationalism, who were in favor of these revolutionary activities, those people could be arrested, could be jailed without conducting any kind of trial against him. So that this rule was passed, and that's why Gandhiji considered it as a Black Act, and Motilal Nehru considered this as snatching away of argument, appeal and advocacy. You just first note down this, after that I'll write more keywords. Please note down. Motilal Nehru considered it as snatching away of argument, appeal and advocacy. The British government gained immense power under this act to suppress any kind of opposition. So it was decided that if any opposition or any suspicious person could be seen, then he or she could be jailed or could be just arrested without any legal procedure. So leaders and people at large expressed their opposition. Meetings, rallies, shows and strikes were organized against it. Gandhiji was arrested in Delhi. When Dr. Satyapal and Dr. Kinchlu were arrested in Punjab, the agitation became severe. The government vehemently tried to suppress all opposition. The prime purpose of this is to suppress the opposition at any cost. Gandhiji was jailed as well as Dr. Satyapal and Dr. Kinchlu. And this agitation became very strong. Agitation means this opposition. Means after the arrestment of Gandhiji, after the arrestment of Satyapal, Dr. Satyapal, and after the arrestment of Dr. Kinchlu, this agitation, this opposition became strong. Many rallies were there, many seminars were there, many kind of meetings, shows and strikes were there to suppress this kind of activity. So this is Rowlatt Act. Now we are going for Jallianwala Bagh Massacre. 13th March 1990, one of the most horrible day of Indian history, one of the most cruel day in Indian history, most terrific as well as dark day in Indian history. We all know what happened on that day in Jallianwala Bagh. Let's see in detail. Timing was 13th March 1990 when popular leader like Dr. Satyapal and Dr. Kinchloo were arrested in Amritsar, Punjab. A public gathering was organized in Jallianwala Bagh in Amritsar on the day of Baisakhi to oppose the arrest. When these two persons, Dr. Satyapal and Dr. Kinchloo, were arrested, so to oppress, or we can say to oppose this arrestment, people decided gathering in Jallianwala Bagh in Amritsar on this day, 13th March 1990. And it was a day of Baisakhi. The purpose of this gathering was only to oppose the arrestment of Dr. Satyapal and Dr. Kinchloo. And this gathering was there in Amritsar. Sorry. Punjab. Okay, students, you just note down this. After that, I'll go further. Please note down. Still, Jallianwala Bagh massacre is incomplete. General O'Donnell Dyer reached there with these troops and without any warning, opened fire on innocent people from the machine gun. So General Dyer reached there with his troop. Troop means with his army. And he just started and he just reached there without any prior warning. And he just started shooting. Or started open firing on innocent people. There were high walls on four sides of the bagh. In the middle, there was unused well, and the only way out being narrow, a number of people lost their lives in the firing. There was four walls, very big walls, around that bagh. Only one unused well was there, and only one entrance. An exit was there, which was very narrow, and Dyer was standing there. So there was no place to go out from that Jallianwala Bagh. According to the government report, 379 people died and 1,200 people injured. As per the committee appointed by the Congress, 1,000 people had died in the firing. Hunter Commission investigating the case on behalf of British governor defended General Dyer. So there was a number of people who just lost their lives. started firing. Thousand people had died in firing. So this 1,000 people, that is the number which was taken by the Congress. Okay. Now, what they just have done with this General Dyer? Hunter Commission investigated the case on behalf of British governor, and they defended General Dyer. Means commission forgave Dyer, considering it as an innocent mistake that happened unknowingly. Means General Dyer was defended. Means there was no any crime against him. He was defended, and this was known as an innocent mistake that happened unknowingly. Means, can you believe this? Means this General Dyer, with intention of killing people, reached there at Jallianwala Bagh without any prior notice, and he just started firing there, and thousands of people just lost their life, and 1,200 were injured, and that's why that General Dyer was defended. He was just released, and this act of killing this kind of people was known as an innocent mistake that happened unknowingly. This was really unfair for Indian people. On the other hand, when Dyer returned to England, he was honored with a sword and £2,000. And when this General Dyer went to England back, there he was honored with a sword and £2,000. Means they just celebrated this kind of cruel things of General Dyer. Got a terrible shock because of this. After this inhuman act, Gandhiji's faith towards the British was completely lost. This event played an important role in untying the whole nation. This tragedy became the ground for the non-cooperation movement. After this Jallianwala Bagh incident, Gandhiji just lost his trust from British policy as well as British government. And this became the ground for non-cooperation movement. So this is Jallianwala Bagh and exactly what happened there. Next is Khilafat movement. During the First World War, Turkey joined German side. So So when England won, the treaty that was made had many firm and unjust terms and conditions for losing side. The Sultan of Turkey at that time was Khalifa, head of Muslims. The movement in India to oppose the strict terms imposed on Turkey and the Sultan came to be known as Khilafat movement. So at the time of First World War, Turkey joined German side. And when England won, the treaty that was made had many firm and unjust rules and regulation. The Sultan of Turkey at that time was Khalifa, head of Muslim. The movement in India to oppose the strict term imposed on Turkey and the Sultan came to be known as Khilafat movement. So those terms and conditions which were just loaded on this Turkey, that opposition and that movement came to be known as Khilafat movement. Ali brothers, Maulana Shaukat Ali, Maulana Muhammad Ali were the chief leaders of movement. Gandhiji requested the Congress to support the movement, keeping Hindu-Muslim unity in mind. The movement became severe with the Congress support. So Gandhiji wanted Congress support in that. So he just requested Congress to unite Hindu and Muslim in this Khilafat movement. So we can say that this movement became severe with the Congress support. The Sultan of Turkey, the name was Khalifa. That's why movement in India to oppose the strict terms, and in that Gandhiji wanted, and that's why Khilafat movement is known. Ali brothers played very important role. Gandhiji requested Congress and this movement became severe. With the help of Congress. So this is Khilafat movement, and you please note down this. After that I'll give you homework. Please note down. Write about Jallianwala Bagh massacre. And The Rowlatt Act. So these two questions answer you have to write in your homework, students. Non-cooperation movement we'll discuss in next video. Till then, take care. Bye. We'll be right back.